There's mounting concern around the long-term impacts of contact sports on the brain. Tonight, we can reveal the first New Zealand rugby player to be diagnosed with CTE. This degenerative brain disease linked to repeated head knocks could, for some sports, have major consequences for both the rule book and checkbook. Here's Mark Kreisel and the one player who could change everything for New Zealand rugby.
Justin Jennings loved rugby, and he had a dream.
You know, from 5 years old, I was just crazy on it. My passion and my dream was to be an All Black, a New Zealand All Black. Unfortunately,
that dream never came true.
Do you think the sport that Justin loved killed him?
I think so. I think so.
He died way before his time, a long way away from home.
I don't want to see anyone die the way my brother died, alone and in dark circumstances.
He's going to go to help others.
But he might just turn out to be the most important rugby player ever produced by Aotearoa.
Justin's life is a tragedy, but his family's decision to donate his brain and the choice to repatriate him to New Zealand is going to save so many lives.
Justin Jennings is the first New Zealander to be diagnosed with CTE, chronic traumatic encephalopathy, a degenerative brain disease linked to repeated head knocks.
This is rugby union, this is rugby league. This is a worldwide catastrophe. How many players have to die before people are going to take this seriously? What is it going to take here?
We lived at the beach, and we were right on the beachfront, yeah.
Small town, Whakatāne, in the Eastern Bay of Plenty.
I walked off the grass onto the sand. What better, you know?
The perfect playground for Jeanette Jennings' two boys.
So how old are they there?
I think Justin was 10. Justin and Blair, 1980.
Sport took control of our teenage life. So he was either playing tennis, off doing rugby, reps.
What kind of rugby player was he?
Tough.
Jeanette? Tough.
Tough for a little fella.
He'd always be willing to put his body on the line. And
Justin was good enough to make Bay of Plenty rep teams in both tennis and rugby.
Here he is.
Toey Seymour played rugby alongside him for the Marist Seniors when Justin was only 18.
Eastern Bay was some of the toughest rugby, hardest rugby I've played. Physical hits, you know, everyone liked to be physical.
Their coach was Matt Tupou.
One's just right there.
He's just a hard player, it's just hard out, yeah. Physicality, that was him.
Justin scored a try down at Rugby Park here with a broken ankle. And he ran over halfway up the field.
Wow. A broken ankle?
With a broken ankle.
You can put a cast on an ankle, but you can't fix a broken brain. Games, practices, over the course of a rugby season, Justin would have taken thousands of knocks to the head.
I do remember of a concussion that he had. He would have been in his 20s at that point.
What sort of shape was he in?
Oh, not a good shape.
Straight out collision.
It's not only the concussions, but what we call subconcussive hits. And those are the generally more mild hits that don't cause symptoms. The player plays right through them. But all those little dings, all those hits, over time, often over decades, increase the risk for CTE.
Neuropathologist Dr. Anne McKee of Boston University's Brain Bank, the world's leading expert on CTE. She's dissected and studied the brains of hundreds of athletes who played contact sports.
A lot of people think it's the hit, the impact with the skull, but the brain is a bit like a ball of jello. It's going to elongate inside the skull, and then it twists. And those twists and the elongation cause the brain to deform.
Back in the 1990s, rugby players would have been completely unaware of what the game could be doing to their brains.
It wasn't just Justin, there were 15 odd on the field that played exactly like that. You took a knock, yeah, you might sort of week out, but most of the time you're back out following set day. I've been down that track. I've had a few.
In his early 20s, Justin headed off to Canada with Toey to play semi-professional rugby.
Canada's, yeah, beautiful place, and the rugby was good, and, yeah, I was there with a mate, which made it better. And
so he played rugby all year round?
Yep. 12 months. Rugby was his main thing.
Years of playing has a direct relationship for the risk of CTE and the severity of CTE. And we've also found that for every 2.6 years of play, you double your risk for CTE. So it can be quite substantial.
Justin finally hung up his boots at 28. He'd been playing rugby since he was 6 years old.
I think his body was just taking too many knocks. His knee and a couple of other injuries that were getting harder and harder to play with, so it just got to a point where he had to change tacks.
Justin didn't know it, but the toll on his brain of playing rugby was still to be paid in full. He moved to tennis, his other great sporting love.
Megan, that's a lot of trophies.
Yes, it is, and there's lots more upstairs too, so.
It took him overseas again, this time to the US. By 2006, he'd settled in Minneapolis and was working as a tennis coach.
And Justin played a part in all these?
Absolutely. Without Justin, the girls would not have won or placed in as many tournaments as they did.
He grew close to the family of Margot and Kevin Mullaney, an orthopedic surgeon. Justin coached their two daughters, Kylie and Regan.
This is the place where you come to remember Justin?
Yeah, on the court, for sure.
Kylie was nationally ranked.
He would come to watch all my tournaments and, you know, with wins, he was happy, but he would always find something that I needed to work on.
It's a big thing to place trust in someone with your children.
Absolutely.
For me as a father, to trust Justin, I trusted him empirically with my girls.
He was kind of like a second dad. He was at all the holidays, birthdays, everything. He was always there.
Justin and his dog, Kiwi.
And he brought that dog to work with him. Yeah. the dog went everywhere with him.
Together, they became part of the Mullaney family.
He was a role model. He was a teacher. He was a friend. He was a second father. I can't put into words what he meant to me.
Kevin, what was your relationship with him?
He was my best friend, my brother. You know, we were really close.
They watched American football games together, and Justin would tell them about playing rugby.
But he'd always say how thick his skull was.
He took some real knocks to the head.
But as time went on, Kevin and Margot started to notice changes.
From the first 5 years to the second 5 years, I noticed an irritability on court.
And then came the paranoia.
I was paranoid about everything.
Taking his dog, taking his car.
He was afraid to go to the grocery store. He was afraid to get on an airplane. Family members look at them and go, why are you behaving like this? But it's actually something the person can't control.
Dr. McKee says these are the early signs of CTE.
So the first changes that we see are depression, feelings of hopelessness, even suicidality is quite common. And we see behavioral changes like poor impulse control, poor judgment, violence, aggression.
Did you talk to him about it?
I did. I said, I need to know what's going on with you. And he said, girl, I don't know. And he cried like a baby. I mean, he just cried.
Justin's favorite sandwich.
The individual senses it. Something's triggering them to act in a way that they don't consider normal. And so they get isolated from their family, they get isolated from their friends.
Back in Whakatane, the family was starting to worry too.
He was saying some things to Mum that I just didn't think were normal. he made a comment to her one day that he didn't want to die.
Because it was during this time where he was really declining, and I said, Justin, are you suicidal? And he turned to me and he said, mate, I don't have the courage to do it. And I was like, whoa.
Justin was living alone and starting to self-medicate.
The last 6 months, he started drinking more.
Yes.
No doubt about it.
But then when we got him in to see the doctor and they started prescribing medications.
The drugs were to treat anxiety and depression. There were lots of them.
And there had to be over 20 bottles. And so I started going through them, and I'm a physician, but I mean, they were medications that you never would want to take in multitude. And I said, well, which ones are you taking? He said, I don't know.
Whatever they were, it wasn't working. His paranoia was reaching extreme levels.
When he was in his car and he called the police because he was afraid that someone was out to kill him, and the police took him to Hennepin County, which is our local mental health facility.
Within days, Justin's body started shutting down. He was rushed to intensive care.
And I was sending messages to him saying, I'm doing my head in. Where the hell are you? I didn't know he was in hospital in an induced coma.
All during COVID, everything was shut down, so they let me into the hospital because I'm a physician. He was intubated, starting multi-system organ failure.
Justin was slipping away fast.
The worst part was when Kevin called me to say that we need to just let him go. To make that call from over here.
We were on the phone.
Blair, his mom. Yeah, he definitely didn't die alone, but...
The cause of death was multiple organ failure.
In the end, did all that medication... Was that the thing?
It killed him.
That's what killed him.
Justin Jennings was 50 years old.
What do you miss most about Justin?
Him. I can only say him.
When we come back, what happened to Justin Jennings?
And I said, Blair, I think Justin had CTE.
It literally was a 20-second conversation that had me hanging up the phone and ringing Boston University.
We have to get it as quickly as possible, ideally under 12 hours.
How are you? Good. Thank you guys so much for coming.
It's 2 years since Justin Jennings' tragic death in Minneapolis.
In New Zealand, the lower-level rugby players are the ones that are growing up, getting concussions.
His mates, Margot and Kevin Mullaney, are throwing a party in his honour.
You know, I wanted it to be done right, and...
Beaming in from Whakatane, on the other side of the world, are Justin's mum, Jeanette, and brother, Blair.
I miss him. Miss him terribly.
Well, I think everybody here misses him.
He's amazing, and we thank you for sharing him with us.
Justin's dog, Kiwi, is here too.
There's Kiwi.
Hi, Kiwi.
Look up here. Say hi to Jeanette and Blair.
They're desperate to celebrate the person Justin Jennings was, not who he became at the end of his life.
Yeah.
Hi, Letitia.
Yeah.
How are you? Good, how are you?
He was somebody very anxious, nervous, and a teeny bit aggressive, which is wasn't him, and I would never want to remember that.
Justin's death left many questions and only rumors for answers. Was he taking illegal drugs? Was he an alcoholic?
Blair called me.
Like, I wanted answers as to what had gone on with my brother and the other side of the world, as to why all of a sudden we've had to pull a pin on a life support machine.
He was extremely upset about this dark cloud of skepticism hanging over the reason for Justin's death. And I said, Blair, I don't think that that's why Justin died.
Tonight on Front. Margot had watched a documentary on CTE and had never forgotten it.
And I said, I told Kevin about 9 years ago, I think Justin had CTE.
CTE, or chronic traumatic encephalopathy, is a brain disease which can only be diagnosed after death.
The minute she sort of brought that up, I already had the CTE coming through in the back of my mind.
Within minutes of hanging up, Blair contacted Boston University's Brain Bank.
Yeah, my name is Blair Jennings. I'm calling from New Zealand. And they were very quick to respond because it's all time sensitive, so.
A team was dispatched to Minneapolis to harvest Justin's brain and return it to neuropathologist Dr. Anne McKee and her team in Boston.
Fresh cases here.
We have to get it as quickly as possible, ideally under 12 hours.
Inside these freezers and fridges lie the brains of some of the USA's most famous athletes, almost all found to have CTE after their lives spiraled out of control. Amongst them, Aaron Hernandez, an NFL player who took his life at 27 while serving time for murder.
I'm horrified. Every time I see it, I wonder why we're not doing something more about this disease. Why are we just letting this go?
On the table in front of us, and with his family's permission, is Justin Jennings' dissected brain.
This is all of Justin, believe it or not. This is Justin's hopes, his dreams, his memories, his emotions, his ability to think clearly, all controlled by this 1,405-gram brain.
The only information she had was that this was the brain of a 50-year-old male.
I know nothing about him. And so when I looked at his brain, I just saw CTE.
There are four stages of CTE. Justin was at stage two. He was already showing the symptoms of rage and depression.
I have to look under the microscope and stain the brain for something, this tau protein. And once I look at the tau protein in multiple regions of the brain, I can make a diagnosis.
What is tau protein?
So tau protein is a normal protein in our brains. It helps our brain function. It helps our brain connect to other nerve cells. But when there's trauma, such as a hit to the head, tau can fall off its scaffolding, sort of fall off its ladder, and it interferes with the normal function of the cell. Eventually, it'll kill the cell.
Dr. McKee found multiple CTE lesions buried in the crevasses of Justin's brain.
They were classic for CTE. They involved exactly the regions that we always see it. And it was starting to involve deeper regions of the brain, so it was getting worse.
It was a diagnosis that answered some tough questions about Justin's extreme mental decline.
Bit of relief. Relief in the sense that at least there was a reason for some of the patterns that were going on in his life before the end, as well as a bit of regret that I didn't see it.
The one thing that we just couldn't grasp was, and couldn't help, was how much suffering he was going through.
Dr. McKee is in no doubt that playing rugby for 22 years caused Justin's CTE.
I think the most important thing coming from Justin's brain was that he played rugby as his primary sport. Under the microscope, they're clearly the perivascular lesions of CTE.
One of the first people she told was Chris Nowinski, head of the Concussion Legacy Foundation.
So this is the first New Zealand citizen with CTE?
Absolutely. The absolutely first case we've ever had from New Zealand.
Chris is a neuroscientist, but he was also once a college football player and pro wrestler. For the past 20 years, he's been on a crusade to convince contact sports bosses that head knocks are causing brain disease.
And now we're proving it, that New Zealand athletes definitely are getting CTE, and now we have one case that will hopefully wake people up.
How many more Justins do you think are out there in New Zealand?
We don't know how big it is, but there's no way that Justin's the only one.
Oh, what a try. In an interview last year, former All Black prop Carl Heyman spoke of being diagnosed with early onset dementia and probable CTE.
To have medical specialists telling you you have dementia, that's a pretty heavy word. And even just saying it sort of rang a bit of a shock through my body.
I think it's important that Rugby New Zealand and rugby and all sports in general take more care in their players and at all levels, not just at pro level.
Neuroscientists are putting contact sports on notice. Change the way you play the game to protect the people who play it.
It's a red card.
Every day we're watching people die. And it doesn't have to be this way. This is entirely preventable. This is a choice. Ruining these men is a choice. And it's not a choice we have to make.
When we come back, is rugby dragging its heels?
The mindset of New Zealand rugby denying the link between head impacts and CT is literally killing people.
Are you on the right side of history?
We believe we are.
No mai anō. The long-term effects of repeated head knocks can have, as we've heard, devastating and deadly consequences for those who've played contact sports. And for the sporting organisations, the impact could be just as far-reaching. But are they ready to face facts?
What happens to the brain when it gets constantly knocked is a relatively young science. But no one has looked at more brains afflicted with CTE than Dr. Anne McKee.
I made it my mission to develop a brain bank for people that were exposed to repetitive trauma to the head through football or other sports or military exposures.
The Boston Brain Bank was established by Dr. McKee and Chris Nowinski 15 years ago. It now has more than 1,300 brains.
This has been an exponential rise, and most of them come in from families who are worried about their next of kin, their loved one, and they want their brain examined.
92% of the brains of former NFL players Dr. McKee's examined have CTE, and that's led her to a stark conclusion.
There is a causal link between repetitive hits to the head and the development and risk for CTE. That is absolute in my mind. Oh, but there is this, see how there's...
That's now being backed up by some of the world's leading neuroscientists. From universities like Oxford and Harvard, the US Centre for Disease Control, to brain banks worldwide, including New Zealand's own, set up by Sir Richard Fall.
I think the evidence is overwhelming. What we perceive the problem to be today was probably going to be much bigger than what we ever imagined.
I feel like this is a special moment in time where leaders in the scientific community have come together to make a very important statement that can save a lot of people's lives if we can just get the right people and organizations to listen.
But many contact sports bodies have and continue to reject this. America's NFL boss, Roger Goodell, denied the link for years.
Do you now acknowledge that there is a link between the game and these concussions that people have been getting, and some of these brain injuries?
That's why we're investing in the research, so that we can answer the questions. What is the link?
And 2 years ago, New Zealand Rugby's CEO, Mark Robinson, gave Sunday a very similar response.
It's simply too early, and we need to do more research.
There was word today of a major settlement.
The NFL have now accepted the link after a lawsuit saw them pay out more than $1 billion in compensation to ex-players for head injuries. So where does that leave New Zealand rugby, our biggest contact sport?
Research, law variations and changes, education on risk, all of those things are present in our game at the moment.
Chris Landrum looks after the professional side of the game for New Zealand rugby.
Do you now accept the link that head knocks are causing CTE?
The science isn't conclusive, Mark.
Excuse me? There's no alternative work. No one's come up with an alternative hypothesis for the development of CTE other than hits to the head. And even groups that, you know, do their best to deny it haven't come up with anything other than hits to the head.
We're not seeking to deny science at all. We're operating on the basis that repeated head injury is not a good thing for rugby players, and we will respond in line with the science as it develops, and we are doing that.
But you are denying the science.
If no.
The science of these scientists says the link is conclusive, then you're denying that.
That's their scientific opinion, Mark. Not everybody holds the same opinion, and we need to do more research.
How confident are you then when you tell parents that their kids are playing a game that's safe and is not going to cause them long-term damage?
I've got every confidence in telling parents that the game is safe to play, but that also they're playing a game with a sport and a governing body that are committed to understanding this issue to the nth degree.
Can I just play you a quick clip from Chris Nowinski?
Chris, play here, okay? You can hear.
The mindset of New Zealand rugby denying the link between head impacts and CT is literally killing people. Full stop. It's dangerous, it's disgusting, and it's sad. And we can't tolerate it anymore.
What do you think of that? How do you respond?
Well, I don't agree.
Rugby says it's not standing still. For example, laws are changing in the amateur game to ban tackling above the sternum.
What difference will it really make if New Zealand rugby acknowledges the link?
It would change everything. The best time for New Zealand rugby to have accepted the link between rugby and CT was 10 years ago. But the next best time is tomorrow.
Are you on the right side of history?
I think the test mark is, knowing everything we know, are we acting responsibly? And we believe we are.
It makes me angry, it really does, because none of us all know enough about this yet, and that's the whole thing. The more we know, the more we can see it in our loved ones if it's happening.
If more study is needed, then that's what's about to happen. Dr. Anne McKee brought Justin Jennings' brain home to Aotearoa on Thursday. A special gift from his whānau to Sir Richard Fall and the Sports Brain Bank.
And in this way, he's going to live forever. He's going to live forever in our research. He's going to make a difference to all the people in Aotearoa, New Zealand.
Hope amongst the tragedy of Justin Jennings' early death.
Getting not just New Zealand rugby, but New Zealand amateur rugby players to maybe donate their brains to help this research. And that no one else has to die the way that my brother and many others have before him.
His legacy will be that he'll be the first Kiwi rugby player to be confirmed to have this diagnosis, and he didn't die in vain. That he sacrificed his body and his brain for the betterment of his fellow Kiwis.
Yeah, so as you've heard, you can donate your brain to science to help research CTE and other neurodegenerative diseases. If you're interested, we have details on our Facebook page.